Bulldogs, and I met a lady out there, Mildred Dimmock, who is 98 years old. Mildred, would you raise your hand? Let's give her a round. And congratulations to you. You're an inspiration for all of us. Well, we are very excited tonight to have our very special speaker and guest with us. And I've given a lot of introductions, and I frequently have used this phrase, our speaker tonight needs no introduction. This sometimes it really is true. Our speaker tonight literally does not need any introduction. Vince Dooley is well known to all of you, and I could spend the rest of the evening talking about his amazing accomplishments as the head football coach and the athletic director at the University of Georgia, the 21 postseason bowl appearances, the 1980 College Football National Championship. It's really an amazing career in athletics, and I do want to read to you what the New Georgia Encyclopedia says. There is perhaps no one person more singularly identified with the University of Georgia than Vince Dooley, the architect of the athletic program's modern-day explosive growth and the shepherd of all things dog. Some of you also know, in addition to his exploits as an athlete and football coach and athletic director, that he is also an accomplished gardener, a horticulturalist. His garden was recently featured in Garden and Gun magazine. Fewer people that I know around the state, though, know of Vince Dooley's passion for history and what he is doing in terms of advancing the field of history, particularly through the Georgia Historical Society. I can assure you that nothing better reflects his passion for history than at 84 years of age, he agreed to be the chairman of our board. And I want to thank you again for doing that, because so many of the accomplishments of this past year in terms of what we've been able to do in terms of teaching history, the record fundraising, have been a direct result of Vince Dooley's leadership for our board of curators. Of course, Barbara Dooley is a big part of his life and has become a part of our lives, and we always want to thank Barbara for allowing Vince to be a part of our lives. So thank you again, Barbara, for allowing us to have him and the leadership that he's given to us. So thank you so much for that. One of the things I've learned about Vince Dooley, and I'm going to keep this as short as possible because I start gushing about him, is I've learned how you have a meeting with Vince Dooley and a lunch meeting with Vince Dooley. And I had to learn this the hard way, but when you have a lunch meeting with Vince Dooley, you look for the table in the furthest back of the room, and you have him sit with his back to the door so that no one will recognize and see him there. Otherwise, you will not get through the lunch meeting, because they come up to him, and always the hands are in this sort of prayerful position, and they say, I'm sorry to interrupt. I hate to interrupt. And of course, I'm looking at him going, yeah, but you are. And I try to introduce myself, and I say, hi, I'm Todd Gross, and they don't care who I am. They slap their cell phone in my hand, and they say, will you take my picture with Coach Dooley? Now, I've determined that the best thing in the future is to say, yes, I will, just as soon as you become a member of the Georgia Historical Society. It's only $55. I mean, what would you pay for a picture with Vince Dooley? I mean, that's a deal. The other great story, and I'll show you something about the awe, and I had become an acolyte of Vince Dooley, but the awe in which Georgians hold him. And I didn't tell this story yesterday when Vince spoke at Rotary, but I think Stan Deaton may be in the room, but I do want to tell this story on Stan Deaton. Most of you know Stan, our senior historian. Vince Dooley visited here. I had met Vince in 2003 at the Leadership Georgia program in Athens. The next year, he spoke at the Hibernian Society here in Savannah. And he was up here doing research. In those days, our offices were downstairs here in Hodgson Hall. And I got a phone call from the reference desk. Vince Dooley's here. Do you want to talk to him? I said, absolutely. So I grabbed Stan Deaton, who was a graduate of the University of Georgia. And I said, Stan, do you want to meet Vince Dooley? Yeah. So we came upstairs. I introduced him. They were talking. And Vince said, Stan, when were you at Georgia? And Stan said, in the early 80s. And Vince put his hand on Stan's shoulder, and he said, those were some great years. We came back downstairs, and Stan was just not saying anything. And I said, what's the matter? You're not talking. He said, did you see that? He touched me. That, I can't think of any more amazing statement than that, and knowing that Vince Dooley has actually touched all of us and made all of our lives better. With that, I'm going to turn the podium over to our special guest, Coach Vince Dooley.
Chair, but I do not understand why he thinks that me being the chair at 84 is something unusual. I mean, Mildred thinks I'm just a kid. Mildred, we love you. You are an inspiration to us all. Thank you. Let's give Mildred a hand. I'm excited. Well, I guess I should tell you about the book and how it got started. I was reading a book by Kent Matheson Brown on the retreat from Gettysburg, and it's quite a book because getting out of Gettysburg and crossing the Potomac was an incredible achievement. But this fellow Deloney, the hero, the fellow on the front cover, was in a battle on the second day of Gettysburg at a place called Hunterstown. And he was injured badly with a sword cut, in fact, three times to his head. And so consequently, he was in the ambulance train, which was 17 miles long. There were 7,000 Confederates that were in that ambulance train going out and being protected by a general named Emboden and his cavalry. But they were harassed the whole time by the Union Cavalry Division and by torrential rain. So when they got to the Potomac, they couldn't cross it because it was swollen. And the Union cavalry was closing in. So they had to form a perimeter around the river, and Deloney gets out of his wagon and rounds up about 200 others that are also injured but are capable of fighting and defending. And he joins that perimeter and helps to hold off the Union cavalry until they finally got help late in the afternoon. So I saw it. This guy is a real hero. And then I found out that in the Harvard Library at the university, the Special Collection Library, there's almost 200 letters between he and his wife. And so I thought in my mind that I've got one more project to go. And that was his book. And incidentally, if I write another book, Barbara and I have had 55 wonderful years together, which is not bad out of 57, I think. But she promised me that there would be no more years if I ever decide to write another book. So where's Barbara? I promise you in front of all of these people that at this moment, I will not write another book.
And I promise you at any moment.
You can always depend on getting a response from Barbara. Because if she has a thought, there is no filtering of the thought. It comes right out. And as I digress for a moment, the fact that in early September that everybody that's a Bulldog fan from the state of Georgia is going to be in South Bend, which is the first time when we play in Notre Dame before we played them in the Sugar Bowl in 1980. And I recall then, as a good example of Barbara having a thought coming out, that we walked into this reception the night before the game. And Barbara immediately spotted among the Notre Dame luminaries and the Georgia luminaries President Hesper, who was a very distinguished president, a great academician, known nationally and internationally. And so I could tell right away Barbara had a thought, and I tried to catch her before she went all the way up to Father Hesper and introduced herself. And then she said, "Well, Father, I know that you and your network throughout the country will be praying tomorrow for victory for Old Notre Dame." Well, Father Hesper, very distinguished, said, Barbara, my God doesn't have time for football games. And Barbara said, "Well, that's good, because mine does." Unfortunately, maybe he did. I don't know. We are going to go up there. So anyway, I decided that when I got the time, that I was going to start on these letters and start on this book. And at the same time, a fellow named Sam Thomas read where I had made a statement in the paper about that, and he had just started transcribing one or two of the letters. So we got together and decided to do the book together. Now, this fellow Deloney, who is from St. Mary's, Georgia, grew up on a plantation, cotton plantation, and back in those days, only the sons of merchants and the sons of planters had access to the university. So he fortunately was, and he ended up being a first honor graduate at the university. He was so good that they brought him back as an instructor in foreign language. And they only had nine in those days, and the ninth one was him, which they called a tutor. But nevertheless, he was a full-time employee as an instructor. And while he was doing that, he worked and got his law degree at the university. Now, at the same time, and this is a connection to this town, is that he fell in love with a beautiful lady here in Savannah by the name of Rosa. And the reason he did is because he used to come here to see his aunt. And his aunt had married a fellow named General Taylor. And the connection is, I see that there's a Taylor Street right down the road, and I rather suspect it's probably named after him. He's an Irish immigrant that came here and was very successful as a planter and a merchant. So he started courting Rosa, and they started writing letters. And some of these are beautiful love letters, which people don't write after my generation. I've got many of them that I've written to Barbara over the years that have gotten preserved. But these people write beautiful love letters back in those days. So there's a lot of love letters when they were courting. Then they get married, and they get married at the Independent Presbyterian Church, not far from here, that you're aware of. And so she stays here, and she grew up on a plantation that, let's see, where's Patty? Patty has already done some research on questions I still have. Now, there is a plantation that she came from, a plantation, and it's Queensboro and Ashton is the name of it. It's 120 acres in southwest Chatham County that we got to find. We got to get Brittany, because Brittany is already located, that once they left the plantation, that they ended up on Liberty Street. And the number I had was 34, but Brittany has now traced it to where it's really 18 East Liberty Street, which is a parking lot. Barbara, I have not taken you by the exact place of where Rosa grew up. And on the way home, I want to show it to you. She's very excited about it. Things that you can tell. So there's the connection. So she moves up to Athens, and they go to the Presbyterian Church in Athens that was built in 1853. And if you go there today, you'll go to one of the pews, about the third pew on the right, you'll see his name, Delaney, on that pew. And that was the pew that the family had when they were going to church there. Now, he was a real patriot, so when the war broke out, he raised a company. He was so loved by his men, he got promoted to company commander, and then he eventually got promoted to a colonel in Cobb's Legion. Now, Cobb's Legion is T-R-R Cobb, which is where Sam Thomas is the curator. And what he did is that this regiment, this cavalry regiment, was so good that Wade Hampton, who replaced Jeb Stuart when he was killed, as the cavalry commander of the Army of Northern Virginia, Wade Hampton said that Cobb's Legion was the best regiment in the Army, North or South, throughout the entire war. And when usually you have that, you got great leadership at the top, and Delaney was one of those that was responsible for the cavalry being so good, because they had such great respect and love for him, because he was dashing, he was always out front, which is a great sign of a commander, but it's also a dangerous sign. Now, what is another tie-in with Savannah is that there are two great-great-granddaughters that I was able to find. One of them is from Richmond Hill. Her name is Emily Carnes. And when I found Emily, she had a bag that big of letters and of pictures, original pictures, that the family had kept, because her grandfather, another person I want you to look up, is one called Carson, who was in the insurance business. And he did a great job of genealogy that's in that. Well, this is beyond the letters that are in the Harvard Library. So I kept those for 5 years and just turned them over to the Harvard Library, because they should all be together in one collection. And so, including all the love letters and everything else. Another great-great-granddaughter lives outside of Athens, close to Madison, Georgia, and she marries Sonny, a walk-on on the national championship team and the three conference championship teams that we had in 80, 81, and 82. His name is Mike Steele. Mike Steele from Winder, Georgia, was a 5-year walk-on that never missed a practice for 5 years, never late for anything. In fact, I named an award after him, the Steel Man Award, and he is the only winner of the Steel Man Award. So this fella, and some of you may have heard of him, name was Mike Steele, or Colonel Mike Steele, because Colonel Steele led a company in Somalia, and he was trapped in Black Hawk Down in there with his company. And he is a decorated hero for fighting and getting his company out of there. He lost a lot of men, but he got the greatest number of them out of there. So he's retired. They have two children. One's a boy and one's a girl, or one's a man and one's a woman. And both of them are West Point graduates. So there must be something in the genes between Deloney and Mike Steele. Both of them were West Point graduates. So you keep running in as you do this research, and that's the fun of studying and doing research, is you keep finding things. Another example is that after Deloney, and they had successfully crossed the Potomac, he had this injury that he had to somehow treat and recuperate. So a fellow officer had a sister down in Stanton, Virginia, whose husband was a Presbyterian minister. So they went and stayed with them. And there's about five or six beautiful letters from Stanton to Rosa and about the family that he was staying with. And I was curious as where in Stanton was he staying. So last summer, I went to Carlisle to the leadership, Army Leadership Corps, and it's about 150 miles, and I went down there and found out that where he stayed, recuperating for a month, was the birthplace of Woodrow Wilson. In fact, it is the museum and the presidential library of Woodrow Wilson that's there in Stanton, Virginia, where Deloney stayed, which is the same place where Woodrow Wilson was born 5 years earlier. So it's these things that, I mean, I can imagine how excited I got when that happened. So I'll conclude with this, that the person that probably knew Cobb's Legion better than anybody, the fellow named Wally Howard. And Wally Howard gave up an opportunity to be an officer at another company to be a private in Deloney's company. So he chose to do that because he thought so much of him. Now, he later became a major and a lawyer and wrote the basic sketch of Cobb's Legion. And he said about Deloney, and he said many, many things about him, that he had three great qualities. One, commanding presence. When you looked at Deloney, you could tell he was an officer in charge. And second, superb generalship. He knew what he was doing. And the last thing, he had bulldog courage. And anybody that's got bulldog courage to me has got a hell of a lot of courage. So that's why we named the book, The Legion's Fighting Bulldog. So thanks so much for coming. Thanks for your support of the Georgia Historical Society. and the great job, Todd, that you've done.
Concluding remarks, I can't add anything to that other than to say Vince, terrific job. It's amazing to me to watch him talk without any notes and do it so beautifully and so eloquently about this project. He obviously has a great passion for it. And we have a passion for you and for what you're doing to help us. So thank you for your membership, as Vince said. We do appreciate it. Please continue to enjoy the food and the drink. Thanks for coming tonight, and we'll see you at our next program. Good night. I do want to remind you that Vince will be signing books right up here in the front. So if you want to get your book signed, please come up front and get it signed again, Vince Dooley.